This is the first in a series of lectures on representation theory. So the first thing I want to explain to you is what is a representation. So what is a representation? So I am given a group G, which in most of our lectures will be a finite group, and then I have a vector space V, and this will be a vector space over a field, and Bas in his lecture used the field of the real numbers R, but in our case it will usually be the complex numbers, but sometimes maybe also over the real numbers. So suppose we have this, then a representation is is the definition. A representation is a linear action of G on V. And what does that mean? So that means, i.e., that means that we have a formula that to a pair sigma V, where sigma is an element of the group and V is an element, is a vector in the vector space, to such a pair we can associate a second vector, and this second vector is denoted by sigma times V. And I want that the map such that if I fix sigma, and that then the map V goes to sigma V, which is a map from the vector space to itself, this map should be linear. So this is if I fix sigma. And moreover, the action, I also want that it is an action, and that means that if I do have a sigma and a tau in G, can everybody see when I write this low? Yeah? No? I should write higher. Okay, such that so I would like to not use that blackboard, so such that if I have sigma and tau in G, then I can compute sigma tau dot V, like I do here. That should be the same as tau V and then sigma. It's some kind of associative property. So this should work for every V in V. And finally, I want that if I take sigma to the identity element of the group E, just like Bas called it E, then I want that E times V is V for all V in V. So that is what a representation is. So it is this is really the representation. It is if I give you a vector in the vector space, and I give you an element in the group, there is a rule that gives you sigma times V. And then you say you act with sigma on V, and the result is sigma V. And that is not any kind of map, it has to be linear. Linear over C. So that is a representation. There is another way to say this that perhaps you like better, so equivalently, you can also say it as follows. So what is a representation? So again, I have G, a group, just as there, and I have V, a vector space over C. Then a linear representation, or a representation of G on V is simply a map from G to the group of linear automorphisms of V. So this is GLV. And a special case, if you take V to be CN, so the standard vector space of dimension n over the complex numbers, then GLV is what Bas called GLN of C, and this is the group of invertible n by n matrices with coordinates in C. So that is what this GLV is. And a representation of G on V is simply a homomorphism from G to GLV. So it is a map. And what is this homomorphism? Well, it maps sigma to an invertible linear map here. And that is the definition. And what is the connection with my previous definition? Well, the linear map is simply this one, the one that sends V in sigma V. So it's really the same. But this is maybe more concrete, because especially if you think of GLV as a group of matrices, then a representation is simply a homomorphism from the group to the group of matrices. By the way, a homomorphism is an isomorphism that was already mentioned by Bas Eriksover, is a special case of a homomorphism from one group to a second group is simply a map that respects the group structure. So you have f of xy is f of x times f of y. That is homomorphism. And this formula is reflected by this property here. This says exactly that a representation in the sense of this blackboard is the same as a representation in the sense of this blackboard. Yeah? So you can choose. Sometimes use the letter R here. So then R of sigma, if you take for V Cn, R of sigma is simply an invertible n by n matrix. Okay? So that's the definition. And the lectures will be about these objects, these representations. So what I will do now, I will give you examples of such representations. So we're going to make the blackboard white. Can you see when I write on top? So here are examples. So I take the Zn, this is my notation, for this cyclic group of order n. So you can think of it as the integers modulo n. With addition, other notation could be Cn if you don't want to choose a model for this group. So let's say that that Zn is has a generated by sigma. So sigma is some element that has order n. So as you change isomorphic, so G is generated by sigma, then I can let G act on the plane on R2. So then G acts on R2. And how do I do that? In a way. And how do I do that? I let sigma act as a rotation. Let sigma act as a rotation over an angle, and so around the origin. Around the origin, and I do a rotation over an angle that has the property that if I repeat sigma n times,
this works. Huh?
You think so? Yeah.
I think it works much better.
Okay. I take the angle is 2 pi over n. So if I repeat sigma n times, if I repeat this rotation n times, I get the identity. And then I can make a representation with this. So let's call this rotation r, the r of rotation 2 pi I over n. And then we know that we know formulas for this rotation, which you probably saw in a course in linear algebra, that the rotation of xy can be given by a matrix, this one, sine phi minus sine phi cosine phi, where phi is the angle 2 pi over n. Yeah? So now I can make a representation with this idea. Jesus. Yeah. No, it's okay. I think okay. It's okay. Thank you. So I will give you the representation in two ways. One time the way I wrote it on the left blackboard, and one time the way I wrote it on the right blackboard. So first, so if I can define this linear action on R2 and as follows, I say that if I take sigma, this element, and I take v, a vector, xy in the plane, then the action is that sigma times v is the multiplication by that matrix. And if I do this with other elements in the group, because sigma is just a generator, if I take sigma to the I, then this is a rotation over 2 pi I n, and then the action is this, and then in general phi is 2 pi I. I is maybe not very fortunate. Let me take it k. K is an integer. We can choose k between 0 and n minus 1. And then this is the this is the formula in the sense of the first definition. Here's the action. If I give you the sigma and I give you a v, then I can compute sigma times v, and this is the formula. And the map that maps v to this is linear. In fact, it is multiplication by this matrix. Yeah? So that is the first definition. I can also say, what is the homomorphism? The homomorphism from the group G to GL of R2, which is GL2 of R. What is this homomorphism? Well, it maps sigma to that matrix. And it maps sigma to the I to this matrix with this angle. That's the homomorphism. So the homomorphism is R of sigma to the I is cosine phi sine phi minus sine phi cosine phi, where phi is an angle that depends on I. And let me take sigma to the k here also, sigma to the k. Phi is 2 pi k over n. This is the homomorphism. And now you may say, oh, but you said you would work with complex vector spaces, and these are real vector spaces. It's okay, this is a subgroup of GL2C. The invertible matrices with real coefficients are form a subgroup of the invertible matrices with complex coefficients. So I can also view this as a homomorphism in this group. And I can also take vectors in C2 and then multiply them by this matrix, and then I get another vector in C2. So I can also do this over the complex numbers. So this is my first example of a representation. So G is the cyclic group of order n, and the space has dimension 2. Any questions about this? So this is important that you understand this. This is the basic. Okay. Here's another example. So this was example one. Now we do example two of a representation. Example two uses the group, the symmetric group. So G is Sn. So these are the bijections from the set of numbers 1 to n to itself, just as in the lecture by Bazé-Dixhoven. So this is a big group. It's a finite group, but it's big. The number of elements is n factorial. And now I will make a representation. So I will let, I don't know, I can always say it in two ways. I can give you the homomorphism, or I can describe to you the action. I describe the action. So I let G act on Cn. So this is the standard n-dimensional vector space over C. So this consists of vectors alpha 1 up to alpha n, where the alpha I are complex numbers. Well, this vector space has a basis, a standard basis. And the standard basis is Ek, is the vector that has zeros everywhere, except in one place where there is a 1, and this is exactly the kth place, so position k. This is a basis, no? And we have this for k between 1 and n, and this is the canonical basis of Cn. And to give you a linear action, so a linear action is determined by what happens with the basis vectors, because then I can write down the matrix that does it, no? So I define then that if sigma is an element in my group, and I take one of these vectors, so I take k between 1 and n, I define what is sigma of Ek, and it is E sigma k. So I will maybe, so that is the, and then I extend it by linearity. No, I want the action to be linear, and I extend sigma from Cn to Cn by linearity. So let's maybe do an example. Let's take a small value of, oh no, not this one. Let's take a small value of n, n is 3. So I will now use some notation that is common for elements of the symmetric group of Sn. And in tomorrow's training session, we will talk about finite groups and how you write down the elements. So S3, I take n as 3 as an example, a sub-example. So we take n as 3, and then we have S3. And S3 is a group of 6 elements, because the order of S3 is 3 factorial, and that is 6. And it consists of 6 bijections. And what are the bijections? Well, one of them is the identity. So now, what are the bijections from the set 1, 2, 3 to the set 1, 2, 3? So one is the identity. The other one is, for instance, that you map 1 and 2 to 2 and 1. You change the order, but you still send 3 to 3. So this is, I denote that by 1, 2. You can do the same with the other elements. Also, I can send 1, 3, I can switch 1 and 3, send 1, 3 to 3, 1, and send 2 to 2. So that is 1, 3, and then there is also 2, 3. And what I can also do, I can send 1 to 2, 2 to 3, and 3 to 1. That is also, 3 to 1, excuse me, like this. So this is also a bijection, and this is, I would write 1, 2, 3. And I can also do it the other way around, which is 3 to 1. So these are if you are not used to this, it will be explained more in the training session. So these are all the elements of S3. And now I want to look at my representation. So it acts on C3. How? Well, let's do an example. So let's take sigma, one of these elements, for instance, 1, 2. Then how does sigma act? So the action of sigma is determined by what it does with E1, what it does with E2, and what it does with E3. Because it is linear. So if I know what happens with the basis vectors, I know what it does as a linear map. I know the matrix. And what happens with E1? Well, here's the recipe. Sigma of E1 is E2, because the 1 goes to 2. So this is E2. This is E1, and E3 is fixed. So this is this is the action. And now if I want to use the definition on the right blackboard, what is the matrix? No, remember that this is a representation, so it is a homomorphism from G to GL3 of C. It maps sigma to a certain invertible matrix. And what is that matrix? Well, it is the matrix, the unique matrix that is associated to this map when I extend it linearly. So E1 goes to E2, E2 goes to E1, and E3 goes to E3. This is the matrix. And I could do that also for other elements. I could also do that for 1, 2, 3, for everything. And then I would get a list of 6 matrices here. Yeah? So this is another example of a representation. Let's look at the easy, oh yeah, the representations have a dimension. So definition, if I have a representation of G, so that means I have a vector space V and G acts on it, or if you like, I have a homomorphism from G to GLV, where V is a vector space over C, then what is the dimension of a representation? It is the dimension of this vector space. That's the definition. So the dimension of a representation that is of a group G on a vector space V is the dimension of V. So this, for instance, is a three-dimensional representation. And the rotations before is a two-dimensional representation. Let's look at the easiest ones that we can imagine are the one-dimensional representations. So what about one-dimensional representations? And then in the exercise session, you can do the zero-dimensional representations that I won't do. So what are the one-dimensional representations? Well, those are homomorphisms from G to GLV, where V has dimension 1. But dimension 1 vector space is C. And the invertible 1 by 1 matrices are exactly all the non-zero complex numbers. So this is C star. This is a multiplicative group, so C star are the complex numbers Z in C that are not zero, and this is a multiplicative group. And if I take the definition on the second blackboard, then a representation of dimension 1 is simply a homomorphism from G to C star. So it is a homomorphism from G to C star. So let's call it R. So it is simply a formula that has the property that R of XY, two elements in G, is R of X times R of Y. So that is, let's do some examples of those. Let's do an example. So I use some properties of the symmetric group that you will discuss in the training session, or you know already. If I have a permutation, then there is the sign of a permutation. No? So if I have a sigma in Sn, then to it I can associate its sign, or its parity and I denote it by epsilon sigma, and this is an element that is either plus 1 or minus 1. Yeah? It is the parity of the permutation. And the epsilon is a homomorphism, because you prove, if you take an algebra course and you talk about permutations, then you prove that the sign of a product of two matrices is the product of the signs. That is the basic property. And then that says exactly that if I go from Sn to the group plus or minus 1, this is R, and I define R, no, I take, this is epsilon. So then this map is a homomorphism. This is a multiplicative group. This is a group, and this says that the epsilon is a homomorphism. So this is a homomorphism. And now this is not yet a representation, because this is not GLV. This is just plus or minus one. But this is contained in C star. This is a subgroup of C star. So this is contained in C star. And I can now compose this and go from Sn to C star. So the image of this map is only plus or minus one. It's not surjective at all. Then this is a one-dimensional representation. You see, this is GL of C. This is a homomorphism. And this is a one-dimensional representation. This is an example of a one-dimensional representation. So one-dimensional representations are very easy. They are just homomorphisms to C star. And in particular, there is the trivial homomorphism that always exists. So I can also consider the trivial homomorphism from my group, any group, also Sn, but in general, to C star. It is the homomorphism that maps every sigma in G to 1 for all sigma. This is a trivial homomorphism. But it is a representation. It is a one-dimensional representation, because by the definition on the second blackboard, I go from G to GLC. So this is a representation, and this is called a trivial representation. Of G. So the trivial representation, by definition, is one-dimensional. It is this one. Every sigma goes to one. It goes to the identity. So what is the action that corresponds to the trivial representation? No, let's go back to the definition on the first blackboard. What is the action? So this corresponds by the correspondence between the definition on the second blackboard and the definition on the first blackboard. This corresponds to a certain action of G on the one-dimensional vector space C. And what is this action? Well, it is the action that corresponds to this homomorphism, which is the trivial homomorphism. And in fact, you get a trivial action. So you get the action that to a vector v in C associates 1 times v. So sigma v is 1 times v, which is v. So the action is trivial. Sigma doesn't do anything. So that's the trivial representation. Here's another definition, another example. It is what is called the dihedral group, dn. It is the dihedral group of order 2n, where n is at least 1. And what is it, the dihedral group of 2n? Well, it is contained in the group of invertible matrices, of 2x2 invertible matrices, and they are the maps from R2 to R2 that are linear. So maybe I do it in terms of matrices immediately. That it saves me some. So it is a group of matrices. So it is a group of matrices A in GL2R that have the property that A preserves the regular polygon with n vertices. And maybe I should be a little bit more strict here and not only ask that A is in GL2R, but I also want that it preserves distances. So what is the regular polygon with n vertices? Well, it is the following. This is a picture of R2. Let me draw it for n is 5. The regular polygon with 5 vertices is the regular pentagon. It is, by definition, this is the unit circle. This is the unit circle. And let me do it. It's not very regular, but you. This is too much, sorry. So this is an angle of 2 pi over 5. It's this one, and then this is also an angle, 2 pi I over 5. You get this one, this one, this one. And you get 5 points. They are all angles 2 pi over 5, 4 pi over 5, 6 pi over 5. And they are the vertices of a regular pentagon. This is n is 5. And now you can show, and I will not do that. If you are very sorry that I don't show it, then you just take what I write now as a definition. So let's see what kind of matrices are there. And if I say that A preserves, it is actually better to say that the map from R2 to R2 that maps V to A times V, so this is a linear map. So if I have a 2x2 matrix, I can multiply with the matrix. That gives me a linear map. Which are the linear maps that preserve this picture? Well, they are, for instance, the rotations that we already saw. But there are more things. What you can also do, for instance, you can reflect in this axis. And you can also do it in this axis. And in fact, in 5 axes, you can do this. And you can write down matrices for these reflections. So what you get is that these are, well, first I write it like this, they are the rotations around 0, 0 with angle 2 pi over k times k over n, where k is between 0 and n. And then they are plus the reflections in the axis. Maybe I don't write explicitly. The first one that I wrote down has as matrix. Now if I reflect in the x-axis, that means that the first basis vector is fixed, goes to itself. And the second basis vector goes to minus. So you get 1, 0, 0, minus 1. Yeah? And we have already seen in the beginning that the rotations are given by these kinds of matrices, cosine phi, minus sine phi, cosine phi, where phi is one of those angles. Those are the rotations. And to get all the other ones, you just take a product of a rotation and this reflection. So the other reflections are that one, cosine phi, sine phi, minus sine phi, cosine phi, multiplied by 1, 0, 0, minus 1. So you have n rotations and n reflections. In this way, we automatically have a representation of the dihedral group. It is some people call it is the birth certificate representation, because it is by definition a group of matrices. So I can just take the identity map and say, hey, this is a representation of the n. So this gives me a two-dimensional representation of Dn. It is the inclusion. Dn is contained in GL2R, and since we promised we would only work over the complex numbers, we just view this as complex matrices. So this is, again, a representation. Yeah? I talk until half, no? Yeah, I think so. Okay. Oh yeah, the regular representation. So there is another sort of trivial representation that you can associate to every group, and that is called the regular representation. It's very important. So what is it? Well, I have a group, so I have a group, G, and now I make a vector space for you, and then I define the action. So what is the vector space? V is the C-span of a bunch of vectors that by definition are independent of, and these vectors are E sigma, where sigma is in G. So for every sigma in G, I choose a vector, E sigma, and then V, by the C span I mean, it is the C times, it is the sum over sigma in G of C times E sigma. So elements in this V are linear combinations of these vectors E sigma. So they look like sum sigma in G lambda sigma times E sigma, where lambda sigma is a complex number. So this, these are one, two, three ways to say the same thing. Excuse me, sigma is an element in G. Yeah, it's a vector. It is a vector, and it doesn't really matter what it is. So by definition, the E sigmas are independent. So sigma, an expression like this, is equal to another expression like this, if and only if all the coefficients are the same.
So we specify a vector for each element in the group?
Yeah, but I do not really need to choose a physical vector. It's just a symbol. And then I have this symbol, and I consider the symbol, and then I take the direct product of it, the direct sum of it. So if you want, you choose vectors in some vector space, but it is not really necessary. So this is the vector space, and now what I do a little bit the same as what I did with the symmetric group. I will act on this vector space by permuting these basis vectors. So here's the action. So the action of G on this vector space V is as follows. It is enough to say what I do with the basis vectors, because it is a linear action. So what is sigma times E sigma? E tau. So I have a, so I take a basis vector, E tau. This is an element in V. Then I take sigma, an element in the group. And now I have to say, what is the action? So if I, what is by definition the product of sigma and E tau? And the definition is that it is E sigma tau. Questions on this?
Sigma tau is the group operation?
Yeah, that's the group operation. Because tau is an index, so that is in G, it's a group operation. If you have trouble with these vectors, you can also think like this. If I say Cn, then I have a base, the canonical basis. Now I have E1 up to En. That's the, I have the, they are independent, it's a basis. If I take the regular representation, then the basis is also a bunch of vectors, but the indices, I do not use anymore these numbers. I do not use anymore 1, 2, 3, 4 to put an index. I use the elements of the group. But if you want, you can map it into some CN if you like. So now I take basis E sigma 1, E sigma 2, up to E sigma m, where G, where the sigma I are all the elements of the group. Exactly, it's the same. I only change the set of indices. That's all. So here is maybe an example. Let's take G is Z modulo 3, Z3. So these are the integer modulo 3, Z modulo 3. So I have three elements, the class of 0, the class of 1, and the class of 2. Yeah? Now, what is the regular representation in this case? What is the regular representation? Well, it is a three-dimensional vector space. Now, the dimension of the regular, maybe I should say that, the dimension of the regular representation is precisely the number of elements in the group, because I have a basis vector for every element in the group. In this case, the regular representation has dimension 3. And it has a basis 3 vectors, and which I index with the elements of the group. So there is an E0, there is an E1, and there is an E2. It doesn't matter that I don't call them 1, 2, 3. It's just I give them another name, that's all. And how is the group action of G? How is the action of G? Well, the action is linear, so it is enough to say what I do with the basis vector. So suppose I take an element sigma in G. Well, then sigma is one of those three. So let's say sigma, I can write it as A bar, where A is 0, 1, or 3. And how is the action? What is sigma times E0, let's say, or E0, what is it? Well, you have to do this. You have to do the group operation with the indices. But in this case, the group operation is additive. This is an additive group. So, sigma, this sigma, is A, is is the class of A. Sigma of E0 is EA, it is E0 plus A, because that is the group operation, which is EA. And in general, if I take EI, where I is between 0 and 2, then sigma of EI is EI plus A. That is the action. I think I stop. Any questions about this last example? Yeah.
I want to ask about the appendages. If we see the representation as an action and representation as a homomorphism.
Yes.
What are the advantages?
What are the advantages? Well, so one of them is maybe psychological sometimes. Is that, yeah, a homomorphism is perhaps abstract, while an action is, well, you see rotations and reflections, you see maybe what happens. Well, the other definition with homomorphism is maybe very clean. It's one line, homomorphism, stop. And this is maybe convenient if you want to prove something. But they are very close. But you can use whatever you like, and even in the middle of a proof, you can change point of view. It's okay. You can choose. But psychology is important. Other questions? Yeah?
I want to ask about the regular representation.
Yeah?
Suppose we have the group is non-commutative.
Yeah.
So is it equivalent whether the action is from the left? Because
yeah, now my actions are always on the left, and you have to take E sigma tau and not tau sigma. Then it becomes an action on the right. And that I. Excuse me?
They are not equivalent.
No, they are not the same. Because e sigma is equal to E sigma prime if and only if sigma is sigma prime. So E sigma tau is equal to E tau sigma if and only if sigma and tau commute. And that is not always the case. Does that answer your question? Oh, equivalent, you mean isomorphic or something. No, I think you switch, you go to a different category. Instead of having left actions, you go to right actions. And you can make some kind of, in fact, there is no essential difference between considering left actions and right actions. I think Professor Eriksov has the final answer.
Yeah, no, I want to confirm what you say. Every group has a very interesting
map of itself. Yeah, and that is an anti-homomorphism. Yeah. Yeah.
It is the same.
Yeah. Thank you.